Presently, we are just waiting for the webinar to begin, and that is why there's no audio. Once we start, then you'll be able to hear to the audio also. I would request the speakers to please once again check the audio.
Hello, am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible. Shivam?
Yeah.
Yeah, hi.
Hi Rajivji, how are you?
I'm good.
And this is Pratibha.
Hi Pratibha, how are you?
I'm good, how are you?
Good. So everybody's eagerly awaiting the session and we're just about to begin.
Yeah. Minute, we are going live on Facebook. Take 20 more seconds.
Yeah.
Shivam sir, can you just start sharing your screen? Stopped.
Yeah, I am doing it. My screen is visible.
Yes, sir.
Yes, it is.
Good.
Sir, we can begin with the session. I'm audible?
Yeah, you are.
Okay. So, dear participants, the webinar is going to start now. So, good afternoon, all the participants. I am Shubham, and on the behalf of Viptel Electrosoft Private, I'd like to welcome you all for this second day of the Viptel Vigyan webinar series, which is on practical issues and case studies on important topics of GST. Has the best range of compliance softwares and integrated services from GST invoicing, TDS tax, XBRL to other professional products like Virtual Office, WebEdge, which are website-based products. We have already satisfied customer base of around 40,000 professional and big corporates. Before we begin the webinar, I would like to request all the participants to kindly switch off their videos. And kindly post the queries in the chat box, which will be answered at the end of the session. As I already mentioned, today is the second day of the GST webinar series. And the topic is for the day is interplay between place of supply and ITC, which will be taken by Advocate Shivam Mehta, which is partner at LKS, along with her colleague, his colleague, CAK Pratibha. So I would like to welcome you, Shivam sir and Pratibha ma'am.
Thank you, Shivam.
Thank you.
By qualification, they are dual qualified with CA and has a law degree and practice as lawyer specializing in indirect taxes. Mr. Shivam, it is designated partner, and Ms. K. Pratibha is a joint partner with the indirect tax of the firm. They specialize not only in indirect tax, but allies laws which are interlinked with GST. Shivam sir has his credit a lot of national and international publications and are part of various industry forums as advisors. He is invited by ICAI and other professional associations as a guest lecturer in various forums across India. They both participate with various trade bodies and help their association in bringing about policy level changes with their valuable inputs and suggestions. Today we have them at our forum to take us through some of the areas of input tax credit and its interplay with the place of supply. So thank you so much for joining us, Shivam sir and Pratibha ma'am. Also, I would like to mention that today's webinar is partnered with CGPI, which has been incorporated to form a National Alliance of Advocates, CS, GST Practitioner, Cost Accountants, focused exclusively on GST. Our vision is to organize the indirect tax community into one common body so that a unified body can be stand up for the interest of professional community, as well as trade and industry with respect to GST. Through CGPI, they aim to weave a platform of leading knowledgeable GST professionals in each state, city, local area to bring all these leaders of community on one platform. Also, I would like to introduce CA Rajiv Khandelwalji, who is the director of Vipta Electrosoft Private Limited, and to say a few words before we begin with the webinar. Thank you so much.
I think time is always short. I think I would request the speakers to begin immediately.
Thank you so much. Sure, sir. Also, I would like to mention that if you face any problem in connecting your audio during this webinar, we're also live on Facebook. So if you go to the WebTales page on Facebook, we are streaming live. You can share that as well in case you face any issue with the voice, receiving the voice. Thank you so much. And I would like to welcome Shivam, sir, to start with the delegation.
Good morning, everyone. Am I audible, Shubham?
Yes, sir, completely, sir.
Okay. First of all, I'd like to thank WebTel and, of course, Rajiv ji for once again giving me an opportunity to take this session. You will be having various sessions on GST. Rather, this week, last week, I have seen so many webinars being taken place, particularly for GST. But the topic which we have selected today, generally the topic is place of supply, or generally the topic is ITC. Today we are going to play, or rather interplay between the provisions of place of supply and ITC. And we will see what are the restrictions, or which is otherwise admissible as ITC, how place of supply plays a role in being a game changer, or you can say a spoiler. So with that, I'll start the session. We'll talk about both place of supply and ITC, but we'll focus on how they actually hinder the admissibility of credit or the free flow of credit, which was the basic objective of GST. Now, as I said, the purpose is introduction of the place of supply provision of service. There are certain areas. This is not exhaustive list. It's an inclusive list. We'll take certain examples to explain what is the problem which is being created because of these two set of regulations which are not properly married with each other. To start with, the place of supply and ITC, there are two different fundamentals on the basis of which they have been made. One was place of supply was actually two was based on destination based tax. So when I look at place of supply provisions, there were fundamental principle behind making those provisions was to see where the tax is has to ultimately go. When I talk about ITC, it is basically that the provision allows you to avail the benefit, discharge the tax on your output liability. Now, these two fundamental principles are actually, if you really look it closely, are actually talking in or pointing towards two different directions. So there is actually an overlap of jurisdiction, destination consumption principle, and tax accrual. You may find it what I'm talking about. Maybe I'm not making sense right now. Give me another 10 minutes. I'll explain what I'm trying to say. And I'll use certain illustrations and I will take you through it. If I compare with the international jurisprudence, when I talk about matured legislations like UK VAT, which has been there for some time, what I see is that the place of supply of service provisions are designed in a manner which shows that where the service is actually being supplied. In other words, when I look at EU VAT is basically a sum of or kind of a guiding principle based on which all international jurisdiction or European Union countries has to base their legislation. The purpose there is to see that if I'm sitting in UK and I'm providing the services in, let's say, a neighboring country, let's say France, Germany, etc., then the question will be whether the services are provided in and consumed in UK or whether it is consumed in Germany. Similar structure is there in India also. I'm sitting in Haryana, providing a service to somebody or providing the goods to somebody in Delhi. The purpose is to see whether the goods and the services are consumed in that, ultimately consumed in that location or not. Now, let us start with a practical example so that you are able to understand what I have been talking about. Let's take a typical example of a hotel service. Now, hotel service being related to an immovable property, generally what I see is the place of supply of lodging, accommodation by inn, guest house, etc., is, as per the law, is treated as somewhere wherein they are located with a, or where the immovable property is located. In other words, if I am in Delhi and I go and use the services of hotel in, let's say, Haryana, the Haryana hotel will be said to have a place of supply in Haryana only. If I go and stay there, I book a room, I'll be treated as using the services in Haryana because of the place of supply of provisions. Now, let us take an example. So, as I said, let's take an example wherein a legal entity X in Maharashtra, their employees goes to Haryana and they book a room and they stay there to cater the customers in Haryana. Now, when the Haryana will charge GST, what they will be charging is, because the place of supply as per the provision will be Haryana, they will be charging CGST and SGST. Now, if X Limited in my example do not have any registration in Haryana, though otherwise ITC is available of these services, there is no restriction under ITC provisions for availing the accommodation services. But because I do not have registration in Haryana and Haryana hotel will charge CGST and SGST, the question will come whether I can avail the credit of so-called CGST and SGST charged by Haryana. With this example, 2 points which come to your mind will be: Haryana GST is obviously something which is specific to the state. Since I do not have a registration in Haryana, the state GST charged by Haryana hotel should not be available to me. But what will happen about the central GST which the hotel is going to charge? Now, otherwise, as I said, otherwise I am able to avail, but Haryana GST I will not be entitled to avail. What will happen for the central GST? Other than that, there could be some technical reasons or technical issues in filing the returns also. I'm not going on the technical part right now. We are sticking to the legal part right now. Now, it's not something which has not come up before the advance ruling authorities under the GST regime. Of course, we cannot use any jurisprudence on this point from the earlier service tax regime because this problem was not. Now, this is a typical problem which has been created because of place of supply, so far as the hotel industry provisions are concerned. Now, if I look at the provisions, quickly I'll look into the provisions. If I look at the input tax provision, input tax is defined under the law to mean central tax, IGST or UGST, charged on the supply of goods or services made to him. When I say to him, to a registered person. So I can otherwise take input tax definition do not restrict me to take any credit whatsoever of CGST, IGST or UGST. Central tax, when I say, is also defined as CGST, and as in central goods and service tax levied under the CGST Act. When I look at the provisions of output tax, why I'm looking at the output tax is Section 49 clearly says that if there is an amount which is available in my credit ledger, I can use it. So it's a utilization provision I'm highlighting. I can use that credit for paying the output tax under this act. And under this act, it means CGST Act or under IGST Act. So if I look at CGST provisions alone, I do not see any restriction whatsoever under the CGST Act in availing the CGST credit in this transaction. Let us see what will happen in case of Haryana GST. So he has received, as in Maharashtra businessman has received a service which has CGST, which we saw. There is no restriction under the CGST Act, so he should be entitled to avail. But when I look at SGST Act, that will be Haryana SGST Act, which I will be looking at. If at all I am able to avail the credit, I'll not be able to utilize it for the output tax under this act because of 49(4). Now, as I said, there is no service tax rulings or past rulings which can be used, but there are certainly some advance rulings which has been rendered in this context. Two of them, one from Rajasthan, another from West Bengal. I'll request Pratibha to explain what these rulings were and what they held, and whether in the light of the provisions which I have discussed, whether they have correctly held, incorrectly held. Please explain that. Pratibha, over to you.
Thank you, sir. So what Shyam sir has been pointing out in this whole matter is that there is a understanding that if the place of supply with respect to, say, hotel services is a particular state, then in that case, the question arises that, and the hotel in high likelihood will also be registered in those, in that state. So CGST, SGST is charged. Credit of that, whether it will be available or not. There is understanding in the industry also of, you know, why should it not be available? There is one sect which debates on that point, whereas the other which talks about, you know, the question of where is actually the restriction in law. So while we went through the provisions in the previous, in the last few minutes, the question came before the advance ruling authority also. So there are two specific advance ruling orders that we would like to highlight. One being the IMF Cognitive Technology Private Limited. So this was basically a software development company in hand, which very categorically went to the authority asking for credit on of central tax that was paid in case of some services that they received, which was an intrastate supply. The authority, in fact, in this case, very categorically mentioned or pointed out in the order that this is a peccant case which has come to them, where the assessee has, in fact, accepted that SGST will not be available, and they have come to them only for the central tax which was paid in the other state. The assessee in this case, the applicant was actually registered in Rajasthan, and he wanted to avail credit of an intrastate supply which he had received in the state of Haryana. The authority went into the first point that when the question raised to them was categorically on central tax, this point led to the further discussion in the order, and they discussed Section 16, your input tax credit, all those provisions, but eventually said that when you are taking credit, which is input tax credit, it is of input tax, and that includes central tax. And in case of central tax, it is payable only in case of intrastate supplies. So when you have received an intrastate supply in another state, then in that case, credit will not be available to you in the state if you are not registered in that state. On the point of registration, maybe I'd like to bring in the other advanced ruling and discuss the two together. Where in case of Storm Communications, it was an event management company where the three questions again that they went and raised was with respect to availability of credit when you were not particularly registered in the state. So it was registered in the state of Tamil Nadu, but it was not, sorry, it was registered in the state of West Bengal, but it was not registered in the state of Tamil Nadu. And they raised these questions on whether central tax or state GST, which was paid in the state of Tamil Nadu, will be available or not. The authority in this case very particularly went into the point that input tax credit is available to a registered person, and unless and until you are registered in that particular state, input tax, which is the taxes which are paid in that state, in this case Tamil Nadu, will not be available to you. So what we can see from these advance ruling orders is that while they have not really examined the details of what the input tax definition is and how they have been novelent enough to cover and include central tax, state tax, IGST, everything, and also that the question of place of supply and registration per se have not really come into the availment of input tax credit, it seems like the advanced ruling authorities have gone really by the principle that if tax was accrued to that particular state where the place of supply took place, that is where the credit should have also gone. So this is where the point of debate begins, that when law has not restricted me, can I apply principles of understanding the concept of place of supply and may ultimately deny credit to the assessee, which does not either qualify for ineligible credit and is also in fact really in the course or in furtherance of business.
Very good. So what she is saying is, I'll summarize that. She is saying these two advance rulings were definitely touching upon certain provisions, but not linking with the ITC. They went with the fundamentals that if ultimately the recipient state has not received the tax, therefore where is the question of ITC? But if I look at, as I explained, if I look at central tax provisions, there is no such bar, which was not discussed in these advance rulings. It's a perfect legal question so far as the ITC of central GST is concerned. So far as the state GST is concerned, definitely if someone closely looks at the state GST provisions, there is a problem. But as I said, these are the two advance rulings which Pratibha clearly said that they have gone on the principles instead of going into the provisions. It will be interesting to see how higher courts ultimately give their decision. To my mind, the CGST can still be litigated. The credit of SGST, in my example of Haryana SGST, is not available because of the bar in the law itself. Now with that, we have come to one conclusion. If I do not have registration in the state wherein the immovable property place of provision is there is definitely a problem so far as CGST credit is concerned. Now you may ask us, sir, what is the solution or how the industry is dealing with it? Let me just quickly give you second scenario, because we have a lot of scenarios to cover. Now, second scenario which we are going to deliberate is, in the same example, let's take a case wherein X Limited take a ISD registration in Haryana. They get the invoice in the name of ISD, and from ISD they raise the invoice to Maharashtra charging the IGST. In that scenario, because many companies are also, wherein there is a regular supply, are also resorting to these type of situations. Now with this, I hope this illustration is clear. I have taken illustration one where I was in Bombay, in Maharashtra. I came to Haryana. Haryana, I said CGST credit can be still away, SGST can be doubted. Client comes back and tell me, sir, what if I take a ISD registration in Haryana itself and raise a ISD invoice on my Maharashtra location? So hotel will raise CGST, SGST on ISD in Haryana. From Haryana, I will raise IGST in my Maharashtra location. Now, whether routing through ISD is a legal solution, we'll quickly look into that. But before that, I want you to very clearly understand this. The Section 20 of ISD, Rule 39 of ISD, they talk about very clearly that if, because I've seen not many companies commit this mistake, if your recipient, if ISD is in Haryana, recipient is also in Haryana, then you will raise from ISD also, you will raise CGST, SGST. If the recipient in my example is Maharashtra, even if the supplier has raised CGST, SGST, ISD will raise IGST invoice. What has happened is, while we have more than 2 years this GST has come, people usually commit two type of mistakes on this ISD itself. Without digressing from the point, I'll quickly tell you that. Now, what generally they commit a mistake is, instead of ISD rates raises correct invoice, ISD write correctly in their return, but recipient, that is Maharashtra, incorrectly avails CGST and SGST. Now, I'll give you a broad situation. What I'm talking here is, hotel has raised correct invoice on ISD. ISD has raised correct invoice on Maharashtra, but Maharashtra incorrectly avails CGST and SGST. Now, what is the solution there? Now, there can be two situations. Of course, it's a wrong head, because again, the CGST, SGST can be questioned. You have to reverse, you have to re-avail. Now, when I reverse and re-avail, keep in mind time limit. If the time limit has already expired, there can be a question from time limit. Now, another situation in the same case is, I have utilized this CGST and SGST and discharged my liability. In that case, there can be a question of interest also. Now, in that situation, we can also look into provisions wherein I can say that there are provisions wherein they say, if you have incorrectly paid output tax, you need not pay the interest. In this situation, we can see if we can use these provisions and say, ultimately the credit is utilized for the payment of the output liability. I have incorrectly paid the output liability instead of incorrectly availing the credit. Therefore, I should not be asked to pay the interest. Again, a litigative point without going in too much into that. There can be a situation where my ISD has incorrectly charged. Again, as I explained, now, if the ISD also commit a mistake, I go back to my first example, credit of SGST can be questioned. Now, when I have given you an option of ISD, what I see is there are two challenges. I may have registration in 10 states, but I am doing these events for my dealers in 30 states. If I give an option of ISD to everybody, what it means is you should have 20 ISD registrations in those states where you do not have a registration. That is one challenge in this scenario. Another can be, what is otherwise not admissible under the law, you are routing through ISD. The concept of ISD means I have an office where the invoices are received, but the services are not consumed, and I transfer the credit using the ISD. Now, these two points, one is practically it can be a big challenge to have these ISD as a solution. Another is that department can question wherein you have more than one ISD registration, saying this is something which was otherwise not admissible. Fundamentally, the credit was to be used in that state. Now you are circumventing the provision of the law. You cannot do it through ISD. These are the two challenges you should keep in mind. Now, I'll ask Pratibha to explain what are the alternative solutions with in this situation, what companies are adopting. Pratibha.
Yes, sir. So, when we're talking about alternative, the question comes that, where, you know, what is the situation when I'm availing hotel services or these kind of services which restrict credit? Those are primarily to do with cases where the company is hosting, let's say, a business seminar for its top executives or a meet for its dealers and all of these situations. That is exactly a situation where your hotel services and all come in. So one thing that the industry has been sort of, making a change towards is getting in touch with event management companies. Now, what do these event management companies do? The arrangement looks like this, that I, as a company, let's say I'm registered in Maharashtra, I would engage an event management company who is registered in Haryana and give them an entire end-to-end job to get the accommodations corrected, to get the the speakers, the stage, the food, everything being done at their end, and give me a single output which is an arranged event. So, but why is this question even coming in? Was because the fact that place of supply provisions make a distinction. Place of supply provisions, when it comes to event management services, very categorically under subsection 7 says that the place of supply is going to be the location of registered person. So while it is known that event management companies, provide services which are bundled and have the entire thing, including organizing the event and services which are ancillary to these events, they have given a leverage that the place of supply is going to be the registered person. So the illustration that we have, the Maharashtra recipient would be the location where he is registered, in which case the event management company in Haryana can raise an IGST invoice, wherein if the Maharashtra entity was engaging the hotel in Haryana directly, then in that case, the place of supply would have been restricted from what we discussed prior to this. So there are two questions which arise here. A, can here the ITC be doubted, given the fact that I know that one part of the services of the event management company is related to place of supply? And second, that the entire bundle of services includes some services which are in the nature of ineligible, say, for instance, food, etc. So this arrangement that the industry is looking at has to be really looked at, put under the scanner, because it puts the event management company as well as the recipient, both into a tizzy, because there can be different set of doubts which can be raised at both ends. Some of them have been highlighted for you here, which include that the department can at the end of the day doubt that the nature of supply that the event management company has declared itself to be providing, that itself is incorrect. It could have never provided hotel accommodation services, because it can provide these only when it has received it. So actually what the event management company is doing is merely acting as an agent vis-a-vis the hotel accommodation services. So P2P was not really possible in that case. But even if that comes in, how the event management company might be able to pull off is by, saying that, okay, I treated these services as interstate instead of intrastate. So give me leverage of some provisions, which is basically section 19, and I can take leeway under it and avoid interest penalty, and I will go and pay the correct tax. The question is, there also it asks them to go and take refund of the incorrect tax, but this amount has already been charged. The books might have been closed. So the question is whether refund will actually be allowed to them, or this provision effectively becomes useless to anybody. On the other hand, neither is the recipient completely safe, because it can always be doubted that the nature of supply that you have received includes within its ambit something which was otherwise ineligible. So the credit to Maharashtra, the entity, should also not be available. Plus, in a situation that the supplier actually takes refuge of section 19, and he changes the nature of tax to avoid interest, that will further jeopardize the credit of the recipient, because the supplier himself has changed his position, whereas the provision does not anywhere require the recipient also to come in or give them any leeway. So this would be, this would end up the event management company as well as the recipient, both of them in a difficult situation.
Brilliant. So I just summarize. She said this. If event management company raises the IGST invoice for hotel accommodation, that is incorrect. One. Two, if he goes and says, I have incorrectly paid IGST, CGST, you treat it as IGST, I should have paid CGST, SGST, you treat it as CGST, SGST only. They will say, okay, you pay CGST, SGST, claim the refund. When he claims the refund, there can be a question, you have already recovered that tax. So at the supplier end, there is a goof up. Let's look at the recipient end. She is saying if the supplier goes and claims the refund and says, admit that he has incorrectly claimed, paid the tax, your credit at the recipient location will be definitely be denied. Also, the earlier decisions, of course, can be used that because he has paid the tax, you go and recover from me, do not deny me the credit. That will help you only in the situation wherein he do not go and claim that he's incorrectly paid. Also, will help you where he is not challenged. If authorities first go to the event management company and say you have incorrectly paid the tax, then your credit is also jeopardized. So the solution of event management availing the credit of hotel is very, very disputable in short. What can be the other problems in this, Pratibha? If you can just talk about other ITC problems, because we are playing an interway.
Hello?
Yeah. What is the other problem in this? When I use the event management, what is the usual industry practice, please?
So, when we were talking about the fact that event management services are engaged, we mentioned that this is normally a bundled service, which is, you know, given to you as event management services. So, and we also know that when a situation of this sort arises, where a seminar is being conducted, a meeting is being arranged of these sorts, the question after accommodation is always food. For that matter, we have seen situations where the payment actually takes place on the number of persons or the number of, you know, food packages, if you could say, and very clearly all accounts team would ensure that they know in the purchase order that this is the number of meals that you are going to be getting and, you know, whatever else. So the other situation is that while I have received event management services, clearly I know that part of it relates to food and beverage, and section 17 subsection 5, which talks about ineligible credits, which is notwithstanding anything else, I will not get credit on this, includes food and beverage. So which means I should ideally not be eligible for credit for the portion of these event management services which actually belong to food and beverage. But to this, the question comes in as to where is the restriction under law. You have not provided restriction for event management services. You have provided for the supply in the nature of food and beverage, while I have received only event management services. So this is, I think, a tricky situation where the question will come in that the department would want to go behind the letter of law and say that you should be looking at what are the, breakup that you are receiving. So I will deny you the entire credit. Of course, we can keep debating on the fact that your specific restriction doesn't apply and all of it. But going beyond it, how is the industry looking at finding a solution to it? What in many situations being tried is that you get a separate invoice. If you break the invoices that you are getting and you know that this portion is for food and beverage, maybe that can be tried for saying that I will not take credit to that extent while I'm eligible for everything else, and I will take credit there.
Very good. Now, okay, so this was only when we are talking about hotels and all. So why we are talking about hotel events, etc. Keep in mind, this problem will be there wherever immovable property provision is applicable. I'll quickly run through immovable property provisions and tell you where the problems can come. So to start with, which says the place of supply or service which is directly in relation to immovable property, including service of architect, etc., 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 is the location of the immovable. Okay, so direct, two words important, directly in relation to the immovable property, location of the immovable property. What do you understand by directly in relation to immovable property? Nothing in the GST law per se. Let's look at what service tax education guide says. It covers within this act, within this ambit, directly relation, lot of services. Take third bullet, for example, services enhancing the value of the property, affecting the nature of the property, relates to preparing the property for development. Fourth bullet, purpose, determination of the title of the property, transfer or conveyance of the property, proposed transfer or conveyance of the property. So they are actually, the term directly in relation to immovable property is very, very widely construed when I look at the service tax education. If I look at EU Council directives, EUAD directives, again, what they have covered within this ambit is on-site supervision also. Please look at and understand what is on-site supervision can mean. Preparation and coordination of the construction work also. So they, even internationally, directly in relation to has been understood as include services which are directly to specific site derived from the land. Example can be on-site security services. Now, why I am stressing on on-site security services is this. The generally, if there is a security guard, which is basically, I am putting a security, I am provider of security agency, and the property is located in Haryana. I engage my security troops in your property in Haryana, but I raise invoice to you in Karnataka because you have a head office in Bangalore. Now, usually what happens is the security services, on-site security services of Haryana, they end up paying IGST in Karnataka. Again, same problem of hotel can come here. Again, because security services, as I highlighted, service tax education guide also covered security services within its ambit. VAT notice also, VAT notice I'm talking about European UK VAT notice. It also covers on-site security services. Even EU VAT directives cover site supervision or security services. So right now, what I have seen as a practice in industry is security service provider, when I'm talking about security, basically the guards which are provided for factory, they do not raise invoice on factory. Sometimes they raise invoice on the head office. Generally, if the head office is in another state, they end up charging IGST, though it is in relation to immovable property. Please look into that. This problem, what we have been discussing for hotel, can come for security services also. How far this provisions can go is very interesting. There can be some legal advisory services which I have given. There can be some services which is of general nature. There can be services which are relating to eviction notice, that I want to get my property evicted, or I want to get the property, in fact, I want to get my lien cleared, or somebody is there, I have issued a notice to them, to the tenant, I engage a lawyer. Whether these services can come within this ambit or not, quickly, Pratibha, if you can tell us how the legal advices in connection with these type of immovable property, how the international jurisprudence talks about it. Pratibha.
Yes. So, you know, like the reason why we are picking up legal services here is that one, the ambit of legal services is very wide. You know, there can be the paradigm can be shifted completely when you're talking about one nature versus the other. So, and all the other, whether it is service tax regulations, the VAT notice of EU regulations, they've all commented on legal services. So we see that one thing that has been made clear is if you are providing services in the nature of advisory, so you are only advising whether it is about the land prices or about, you know, fundraising for a property acquisition, or, you know, basically where you are not, you are, your legal services are restricted to advices being given to terms of the contract or how to do it. There it has been said that you, it will not be considered to be directly in relation to immovable property. Whereas in other situations, say for instance, you have cases where it is the legal services are for planning permission or it is for transfer of title of the movable property. That is where I see a direct relation between the interest in the property that will be transferred. For that, I have engaged legal services. I have engaged, you know, lawyers for drawing up contracts for undertaking the sale of an immovable property. In all these situations, they have said that these will be considered to be in relation, directly in relation to immovable property. We do not have, let's say, a straitjacket formula for all these kind of services. But one thing which sort of comes out in this is you have to find the, you know, nexus between the property, the fact that, you know, to what extent it is of usage of the property, etc. And that can help you decide whether these services can be said to be directly in relation to immovable property or not.
Very good. So I hope she's clear that there is no straitjacket formula. Find the link. How closer is the link? It is in relation, then it can be said to be in relation to immovable property. Even the legal services as such as conveyancing, drawing up the contracts, in UK VAT has been considered as having a direct link. Even in our EU VAT, they talk about legal services relating to transfer of title to the immovable property as having a direct link. So very, very, when we are talking about anything relating to immovable property, be very clear. One thing I want to take it as an example also, nothing to do with legal services. Somebody has been asking, so if I let the location of immovable property is the test, it's not the recipient which is a test. I take a typical example. I am the owner of the property. I am in Noida. My property is in Gurgaon. Recipient is in Delhi. So owner is in UP, property in Haryana, recipient in Delhi. In this case, place of supply will be Haryana. I will raise an IGST invoice saying the place of supply is Haryana. I am in UP. I am as a provider in UP. Place of immovable property, Haryana. So I'll raise IGST payable in Haryana. Even though the occupant who has taken the property on lease in Delhi, I will not say IGST in Delhi. I'm making it very, very clear. It will be IGST Haryana. Now, let us look at most technical, I feel. This is very, 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 very smoothly worded provision, but mostly this is understood incorrectly by many people. What provisions I'm talking about is where the supply involves movement of the goods, whether by the supplier or the recipient or by any other person, the place of the supply of such goods will be the location of the goods at which the movement of the goods terminates. So if I enter into a, typically what the provision is saying, if there is a contract for supply of goods by a person sitting in Haryana, the contract is FOR and my contract is to deliver the goods to somebody who is in Haryana, the place of supply will be Haryana. That is purely how the provision says. Then second provision says where the supply does not involve movement of the goods, whether by the supplier or the recipient or the place will be the location of such goods at the time of the delivery to the recipient, at the time of delivery to the recipient. Now these two provisions, if you keep it together, along with your ITC, of course, there can be a problem. Let us see what I'm talking about with the help of an illustration. I am a customer, I am a supplier in Haryana. I enter into a contract with a customer in Delhi. Customer comes to Haryana, he procures the goods from Haryana, take the possession of the goods at my factory, and then the goods are then brought back to Delhi by the customer. In this scenario, whether it will be held to be 10(1)(a) will apply or C will apply, whether there is a movement, whether the supply involves movement or whether supply does not involve movement. Why I am raising this question is, please also look into this, that this movement can also be by the recipient. It need not be necessarily by the supplier. In this scenario, in a simple example, in these set of facts, can I say I will charge IGST to the customer in Delhi and the customer will be able to take the credit? If I charge CGST, SGST, as I explained in the beginning, the credit of SGST is definitely gone. So far as CGST is concerned, that will also be disputed by the authorities, because advance ruling is against you right now. So, movement by the recipient, what do you understand by that? Typically, I took an easy example of FOR. Generally, that is what people take. FOR, I don't have a problem. If the contract is FOR, I have to deliver to your state. No problem. IGST can be charged. Now, in this situation, X work. But the moment customer comes, take the goods from my factory gate, take it back. Can I charge IGST or CGST, SGST? Before we go into the question, let us understand. If Pratibha can explain. Pratibha, please explain some important judgments of sales tax. Also, make sure while you are explaining, what were the facts? What is the difference? To what extent I can use? Please, Pratibha, over to you.
Before I venture into the judgments, one thing that I want to make clear is we are not on these judgments on whether the taxability was right, it should be sales tax or what. But the judgments are being referred to understand as to when does the movement become part and parcel of the supply, or where can you say that the sale actually involves movement of goods, and to draw in the whole test of the so-called inextricable link between the movement and supply of goods. The first case that we would like to discuss is Tata Engineering Locomotive Company of 1977. Here, the facts surrounded around the fact that the company was actually registered in Bombay. It was an SSE in Bombay, making sales from Bombay. The factory of Telco was in Jamshedpur in Bihar. The contracts with dealers to purchase trucks, chassis and spares, everything, was actually between Bombay and the dealers, because Bombay was the headquarters and that is where the contracts would take place. The contracts in these cases very clearly put down the terms. They said that A, the goods have to be taken by the dealers from the factory in Bihar, that is Jamshedpur factory. B, that is where the delivery is going to take place. That was also coming out in the contract. C, there was areas which were assigned to these dealers where these goods will actually be moved to various parts where we see dealers are assigned territories, and that it is in those territories that they can make their business ultimately. So the contracts with dealers also mentioned that you have to take these goods and undertake your business in the territories defined to you, to such an extent that if it is not fulfilled, these conditions are not fulfilled, then it will lead to breach of contract between Intelco and the dealers. So here what we can see is there the supply or sale which was to take place between Telco and the dealers, though the terms or transfer of title was to be at the factory which was in Bihar, but for every purpose it was known that these goods will be moved from the factory gate of Bihar to the respective states, and therefore the court said that this movement or interstate movement between the goods from one state to another, that is from Bihar to outside Bihar, was, there was an inextricable link between these supplies and the movement which was taking place. So despite the fact that there was a delivery at the factory gate, it was held that the movement was part and parcel of the e-sale which took place, and accordingly they were in one sense. How do I apply it in the present case? To basically, the question is, how do I apply it in the present case? The number one, the language right now is not really whether this state actually occasioned the movement of goods from one state to another or what, or it doesn't even uses the expression inextricable link to be established. What we are trying to draw is that the provision still in essence requires that the supply has to involve the movement of goods, which means you have to go into the contracts or the terms between the buyer and the seller that despite the transfer of property being at a particular place or a location, look at the entire contract in a holistic way and determine as to whether the sale or the supply that you're looking at will involve movement of goods necessarily. And number two, where does the ultimate delivery to the recipient takes place in this contract of supply, keeping a lot of other factors into consideration and not particularly on where the transfer of title takes place.
So very good point. I'll just highlight the last point. What she is saying is, merely because there is an X factory sale doesn't mean CGST, SGST has to be applied. X factory sales or sales at my factory gate means property is being transferred. The question is whether the supply, the contract of supply of goods anywhere mandates the movement of the goods from one state to another. Now, Pratibha, I've understood the law. I've understood the provisions. I'll give you two illustrations. You tell me where I'm wrong, where I'm right. Illustration number one. I'm in Delhi. After the lockdown, I want to buy let's say, a good car. I said, I have enough. I want to buy a big car. I find from the dealers, they said, no, I don't have delivery. If you want to go, you go and buy from somebody, another shop in Haryana, you go there. So I go to Haryana, I place the order, I buy the car, and I say, I'll drive down the car to Delhi. You charge me whatever you want to charge. In this example, I also tell them that my address proof is of Delhi. Let's say I'm already registered, I also tell them that my GST and MPC has to be taken care of.
So firstly, congratulations on the new car. One I would say is that factors that you have provided right now, I wouldn't say they are completely sufficient to determine what would be the place of supply. But yes, there are indicators. Number one, that you mentioned that you are informing the dealer that you are going to be, you know, using your residing in Delhi, your GSTN number is in Delhi. So you'll be practically using the vehicle in Delhi. But what you'll have to go a little one step further is the contract between you and the dealer, because we see as a general practice that the dealers have an ex showroom delivery terms, you know, though. So even if you say that you are registered at a particular other address, their terms would say that I am delivering the vehicle to you in their showroom. The vehicle might move to another place. It will come from the stockyard. It might go for registration to another place, but ultimately delivery takes place in the showroom. So what we'll have to see is whether the terms between you and the dealer are sufficient enough to ultimately determine that A, it involved movement and the movement is for delivery in Delhi. From what I can see, because the terms between you and the dealer right now are only indicating that it is an information provided to him that it will be consumed elsewhere, that is not conclusive enough to say that it is part and parcel of the supply, as per my view.
Very good. Now, I'll change the situation. In the same example, I say to the dealer in Delhi, there is hardly a buyer. I am buying your car. I will pay to your Gurgaon showroom address. At my behest, send somebody with the car to my location in Delhi. Your answer will change. In other words, the dealer is incurring the transportation of the goods. Under the terms of contract, I tell him the property is my property at your factory gate, but you drive those vehicles to my house till Delhi. Would your answer change?
Again, I wouldn't say my answer would change completely. of course, one additional factor which comes in here is that you have added that the terms of the contract are going to include that delivery, you know, has to take place at your end, at your address in Delhi, whereas the person who is, and the dealer is going to assign a person, maybe one of his drivers, to drive the vehicle to you. But there was one more factor that you mentioned, was that you transfer the title to me there, and then you are then let one of your drivers drive the vehicle to me in Delhi. So question here also can come about that the transfer from Haryana to Delhi is taking place because you have practically or constructively taken delivery of the goods in Haryana, and then as a separate activity, more like a goodwill gesture, that you bought an expensive vehicle from the dealer. So therefore he says, okay, I'll deliver it to you. Or if you say no, and between the terms as to where ultimately the sale is going to get completed in terms of possession, title, risk, everything, and you're saying this movement is taking place part and parcel of the sale, then in that case, we can say that the place of supply will be Delhi.
Now, why we were discussing this topic is, there can be n number of scenarios. There can be a scenario wherein I only ask the supplier to deliver the goods to me. There can be a scenario that the supplier knows. I go to Gurgaon and buy a laptop and tell him, this laptop I will take to Delhi. That's not sufficient. What we need to have a clear inextricable link under the documents. In this COVID lockdown situation, once the lockdown is over, that is a problem which we are already facing so far as the essential commodities are concerned. Going forward also, you will see there is lot of cases wherein dealer will come to the factory outlet, dealer will come to the warehouse. Although the terms will remain unchanged, he will do this transportation. There we have to very, very clearly see what the document says before we conclude IGST will apply or CGST, SGST will apply. Now, right now also many distributors are coming to the warehouses taking the delivery, and the terms of the contracts get changed. We don't know what is happening in that situation. There is no documentation to that extent. There are cases in VAT. Those cases, there was very well established in the contract. Supreme Court judgments saying, okay, it will be an interstate supply. Again, to apply them in the GST will also be a challenge, but at least we should be very, very clear what we should mention in our contract of sale. With that, we will come to another issue, warranty transactions. Again, here we are talking about bill to ship to situation. Now, everybody knows bill to ship to. I just, for the purpose of bringing everybody on board, if I bill it to A and at his request, I give it to C, I am B, my place of supply will be where the A is located. So what should be important is, in bill to ship to situation, is there should be a movement of the goods wherein there is movement of the goods either before or during the movement of the goods, there is a transfer of documents of type N. Let us take an example to understand how it can be, have any implications so far as the warranty is concerned. Now, again, let us stick to the example of motor vehicle because we have been talking about motor vehicle. Now, I am a OEM, I am a manufacturer of car, I have a plant in Delhi, I have a dealer in Haryana, I have given warranty of my vehicles to my customers. Customers in Haryana who has bought the car vehicles from dealer, they go to the dealer and get the vehicle repaired at their workshop. Now, I tell the dealer that because I have given the warranty to my customers, you repair these vehicles, whatever is the part cost, whatever is the service cost, you recover from me. Don't recover anything from the customer. Now, in this scenario, what will be the situation? Can dealer raise IGST invoice on Delhi, saying it is billed to Delhi? He can he say that I'm billing to Delhi and I'm shipping to the customer in Haryana? Pratibha, you want to take this question?
Yeah.
Hello. Yeah, Pratibha. Hello?
Hello? Okay. Hello? Am I audible now?
Yeah, you are. Yeah. You take up this question. Huh?
Yeah. So, the like what we're discussing in case of warranty, in case we say that the vehicle... Okay, before that, I'll just for a moment quickly talk about or slightly mention section 10.1 B and C, that it requires movement. And the movement can be before or during, you know, before or during the movement of goods, there has to be the direction from the supplier that the goods have to be given to another customer. So when it comes to warranty, this question which gets raised is, typically the situation was the parts were actually received from the manufacturer and by way of movement, and then the vehicle will then get fitted with this replacement part, and then the replaced part is going to be moved from to the customer's premises. In fact, some dealerships actually offer that the vehicle will be particularly delivered at the customer's premises only. So for in that sense, there is movement as part of the e-transaction that we're talking about. But what can happen here is that the doubt which gets raised is that the department can say that under warranty, you are making a supply to the OEM. And when you talk about the supply is replacing the part in the vehicle at that stage. So which means that if the terms of the supply or sale actually get complete when the part was replaced in the vehicle. So therefore, technically, there is no movement involved. But like we were discussing about various issues on where ITC gets blocked and everything. There is one school of thought in the, industry, or in fact, even among tax experts, which say that if I am saying that the vehicle is going to move along with the replaced part, therefore, this is the movement that was envisaged under 10.1B for bill to ship to scenarios, and I could take credit on this. But it is very clear that this view is not, you know, one of the cleanest views which are possible because of the very commercial arrangement of it, that we all know that it is not in all cases that car is actually delivered to the customer's premises. In many cases, you actually take the delivery of the goods at the premises of the dealer itself. So this is something that we still require clarity, although it is a regular day-to-day transaction.
In fact, if I take an example of, let's say I go and get my mobile phone repaired under warranty, I give a mobile phone across the counter. He replaced the part and he give it back to me. Let's say the screen of the mobile phone is broken. I give it to him. He replaced the screen and give it to me across the counter. There is no question of movement at all there. Again, the bill to ship to, which has been currently adopted by all consumer durables in these type of transactions, saying that dealer is providing a service to OEM in or the brand owner in Delhi and the shipping it to the customer is highly doubtful in this. Yeah. So this is some areas wherein this type of problem can come. I think there are a lot of people who are asking questions, but I'll try to, I think this is the last one situation which we have picked. There could be many other, but we have picked up most hot selling type of situations which are coming. One is the case wherein I'm taking an example of, I am a manufacturer of, let's take components of automobile, or I'm a manufacturer of components of, let's say, fridge, AC, etc. To make the components, I have to also build a mold. So before making the component, I make a mold. Using the mold, I make the component. But generally what happens is, because I have invested a lot of money in making a mold, there is two transactions which take place. I sell the mold to the customer. The mold remains with me. And using the mold, I start making components and then sell the components to the customer. So far as the component is concerned, because there is a movement happening from the manufacturer in Haryana to the buyer in Delhi, IGST can be charged. But so far as the mold is concerned, because there is no physical movement of the molds which is happening, the molds are in Haryana, remain in Haryana, used by me in Haryana, charging IGST, which most of the companies are charging, is very, very doubtful. This is one proposed model wherein people are doing this. So definitely, intention of the government is not to increase the transportation. But what is happening is sometimes to ensure the movement of the goods, the molds are transferred from Haryana to Delhi. And then it is brought back to Haryana. Now, in these type of cases, I still feel because of the strict reading of the section 101B, I can say there is a movement of the, or 101A, there is a movement of the mold which has happened. But again, there is a bill to ship to, I have billed it to him and he has shipped it back to me. 101B can be used. But to merely incur the transportation can never be the intention of the authorities. But how the provisions are worded today in this scenario, there can be a problem. That's why you want to add something on that?
No, sir. I think we can move.
Okay. Now coming to another situation. Now, second scenario in this case is I further break it into two contracts. I'm talking about the contract. So my first situation was contract. There are two contracts: contract for sale of mold, contract for sale of component. Scenario two I'm talking about is contract of making the mold is further broken into two. Now what happens is the first, there is some design R&D done on the tool. R&D is shared to Delhi. R&D, once shared to Delhi, he approves the R&D, then it comes back to me, then I make the mold, then molds are used in further manufacturing. Now so far as the R&D services are concerned, in this typical example, I can still say the place of supply of these services is the registered location of the recipient, which is Delhi. But again, mold, because they are not physically delivered in this example, I see a challenge to say the place of supply will be Delhi. I think with this, we can take up some questions and we have taken certain examples. Definitely, we can take up the question because these are only broader provisions which we are talking about, which we have spoken about. Read up the questions and there could be other situations also. I think people must have mentioned their situations. Again, as I said, there is no perfect solution, but we can definitely work towards having a proper documentation. To start with, I think there is one question which says, do a proprietor require registration in case doing only export, supply of services and turnover in 19 lakhs in Punjab? Is he exempted under notification 10 of 2017? It is more of question of registration. Pratibha, you want to attempt that? Or we will first take up the questions on the issue, because I think this is more of a general question. We will separately address to them in the private chat box.
Shivamji, I'll also take up some questions from the chat.
Please do it.
One question is ABC Export Limited is engaged in the business of exporting diamond out of India. ABC Export wants to take few diamonds out of India for an exhibition. Whether such diamonds taken out of India are required to be treated as exports under GST? When the unsold diamonds are brought back into India, whether such diamonds will be liable to IGST on import of such diamonds?
I think, sir, normally when I'm exporting the goods, that will be subject to IGST when I'm exporting. But there was some relaxation which was given in the context of exhibition, etc., if I'm not wrong. There is specifically some provisions which were introduced for that. You can look into them and separately address.
Okay. Then somebody is asking, Amit Kumar has asked, what is place of supply in case... what is place of supply in case of purchase of goods at contractor site from the same state?
Please. Sir, which question you are saying?
Just a minute.
What is place question. Of supply in case of purchase?
Purchase of goods at contractor site from the same state.
Okay. Pratibha, you want to take this?
Yeah, so the I think the question in, means that there are goods which will be directly taken to the contractor site, but there's a possibility. There's a possibility that I, as the purchaser, might be registered somewhere. I believe that is where the question is coming from. So yes, because this is involved, I am assuming that there are only two parties involved here, and the movement is taking place, but movement is going to terminate in the same state, so it would become a intrastate supply. Of course, there can be other models possible. The question is not posing those other models here. So it will be intrastate in this case.
Right. So another question is, corporate office Karnataka wants to buy a car for an executive from a showroom in Tamil Nadu, but company would like to the car to be taken RC in Karnataka, but invoicing shall be on Tamil Nadu branch office. Is it possible? Please explain invoicing and ITC. Was the question clear?
Pratibha, you want to take this up?
Yeah, so what I understand is primarily it is talking about whether the vehicle can be, you know, registered in another state, whereas the invoicing will be here. So right. Number one, we were discussing the registration, you know, activity for one, it is under the Motor Vehicles Act and registration rules which are provided. When it comes to only GST, the mere fact that it is registered in another state is not going to, you know, change the place of supply. Like we discussed, it is ultimately that the contract should involve movement, and that should ultimately lead to delivery at the showroom or in another state, which is going to determine where the place of supply is. So in terms where the question says, is it possible? The answer is yes, it is possible, but it will all depend on the terms between based on which you're purchasing from.
Thank you so much. And there's a very common question everybody is having. I think please give an answer to that if you've not already given that. Sachin Jain is asking, I'm registered in Maharashtra and I have rented a property in Delhi. Will I charge IGST or I'll have to take the registration in Delhi?
So if I have rented a property in Delhi, means I have taken the property on rent. This is what they mean. Or I have given my property on rent.
He's given his property on rent.
So I did not take the registration in Delhi. Sitting in Maharashtra, I can raise the IGST invoice, which will say place of supply as Delhi. You need not take separately a registration in each state where the property is there. Only thing is, he will raise the IGST invoice in those states, payable right. At Delhi. Yeah.
Right. Then there's a question from Rohit Chaudhary. If a transporter is registered in Rajasthan, transports the goods to Haryana, what is the place of supply? Should the recipient of service have to charge any RCM in IGST or CGST, SGST?
Why you want to take this up?
Sir, I'm not too clear on the question. So can you repeat or I can find it in the chat box?
If transporter is registered in Rajasthan, he transports the goods to Haryana, then what is the place of supply? Should the recipient of service charge RCM?
So, hello. Ajit, I've seen that. So place of supply will be, so he had to pay IGST in Haryana.
Okay. And can you please explain the free services provided to customers under the free service coupons in automobile industry? What will be the GST implications on that?
Hello, Shivam sir, you are not audible.
Shivam ji, you are there? Both of the speakers are not there?
I can hear you.
Yeah. So maybe, ma'am, you can answer the question.
Yeah, I'll take it up till then. Yeah. So when the question talks about free service coupons, which is basically when you purchase the vehicle, the dealer tells you that take these coupons and the first three services are going to be, you know, free of cost for you. That is, I believe, what they're talking about. So in this case, what happens is this is to a large extent, it is comparable to warranty because the fee, though it is called fee, we all know for a fact that it should be, you know, somewhere factored in the cost and all. But when, as far as I as a dealer is customer is concerned, I go and, you know, approach the dealer to provide services to me. So whatever he undertakes as part of the activity which is involved against the free service, which is they'll change the oil or, you know, normal servicing to take place, I don't pay anything to the dealer. There is no separate chargeability of GST on that. But the dealer has for sure done some activities there and he has consumed some goods, provided services which have a cost attached to it. And those have been provided. There are two situations possible, that those have been provided in, you know, under his own account, or it could have been provided based on the you know, responsibility of the manufacturer. If it is on his own account, then he has already factored in his profits, so no other separate chargeability again. But in a situation that it is actually the responsibility of the manufacturer which he is fulfilling, then the dealer goes and charges for that from the manufacturer. And on that, again, chargeability of GST will chip in, similar to what we talk in the warranty transactions, that there could be supply of goods, there could be supply of services. And again, the problems will arise in this.
Okay, thank you so much. Then, Shubhamji, is there?
Yes, sir, he has joined.
Okay. Then a question is from Kishan Kabra, that my customer is outside India. He has given us order to deliver the goods at Gujarat. Payment will be done by my outside customer in foreign currency. What is place of supply? Should I repeat the question?
Yes, the first part.
My customer is outside India. Mm-hmm. He has given us an order to deliver the goods at Gujarat in India itself.
Mm-hmm.
Payment will be done by my outside customer in foreign currency. Place of supply.
So place of supply will be Gujarat only. The fact that your customer is outside, or the you know, consideration is going to come in foreign currency, is not going to, you know, per se affect it. And maybe they're also asking it from the perspective of export, you know, whether it will qualify as export or not. These situations are those where it will not qualify as export because the goods remain within India. And it will be Gujarat in this case.
Even though the billing is outside India?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Then there's a question from Subodh Sharma regarding build to ship to. Suppose I order to OEM to purchase an empty vehicle like this is to bill me as Haryana state and ship to me as Haryana state, but consignee address will be XYZ as empty state. Is valid pattern under GST law and provision?
So both these are different entities. Bill to party and ship to parties are going to be different parties, different entities. Then yes, it is valid, and it will place of supply will be determined on based on 10-1B, based on where he is registered. So it's fine.
Then there is a question: outdoor catering service receipt for serving food to employees. Whether we are eligible to take ITC since we are paying tax on supply of food to employees?
So though the question is otherwise not pertaining to place to supply, but principally there will be other restrictions here. So fundamentally the answer would come down to no, but because of a lot of other reasons.
Okay. Shivamji is there?
Yeah, sir. Just joined. I think they got logged out. Yeah.
Okay.
Are we done or we have some more questions?
No, there are a lot of questions. One is from Kishan Kabra CA. One of the group company paid salary and other allowances to directors of group company. Now the company wants to reimburse the expense from the other company. The GST is applicable.
Yeah, GST is applicable. If you want to claim from the other company, you cannot simply say it's a kind of an agent. It's actually a service, and the cost of the service, the GST has to be charged.
Okay. In the meantime, you can also see the questions. Let us do it so
that it happens. I will
take one question. Hello.
Yeah.
Please. I'll take a question, sir. So a trader comes from Mumbai from Bangalore, purchases 30 sets of mobile valuing 90,000. from a showroom in MG Road, the showroom prepares tax invoice stating Bangalore address. Showroom wants to know that the tax to be charged either treating in the same intrastate supply or interstate supply. On the backdrop of the fact that a trader was from Bangalore, has taken delivery from Mumbai. At showroom, generating the e-way bill in the name of buyer would change the nature of transaction. So should I repeat? Hello?
Yeah, Shyam sir, you want to take that or I'll answer? So I think Shyam sir is not connected. So this one also is pretty much similar to what we were discussing earlier, that I know that the address of the customer is outside, but and he will be using it somewhere else, but it will come back to, I may sound repetitive, but it will come back to whether the terms of the contract involve movement. From the plain simple question, it does not seem like the movement, you know, there is movement in part of the supply here concerned, only an information that the supplier belongs to another state. So therefore, it seems like a intrastate supply unless we add in more terms. Secondly, e-way bill is not going to change the nature of supply. No.
So one more question is related to IGST, where the place of supply is an another state. Warehouse is in Haryana and the owner warehouse is in UP. Person taking premises on rent in Delhi and register in Delhi only. UP person will change, will charge.
Sorry to interrupt. Could you repeat? There was some signal issue here. Yeah.
So can you hear me now?
Yeah. It's better now. Yeah.
So it's a similar sort of a question which asks that IG, just a second. IGST, where place of supply is the other state, like a warehouse is in Haryana, owner's warehouse in UP. The person taking premises on rent is in Delhi and then registered in Delhi only. UP person will charge IGST to Delhi, whereas the supply is in Haryana. Whether Delhi person will be able to take IGST credit?
So if it's about IGST credit, then legal provisions are not really restricting in that sense, but yes, the place of supply issue can come up, can be taken by the department later.
Sure. So I'll take another one. E-commerce operator registered in UP and again purchase packing material from Delhi and send directly to supplier in Delhi. What was place of supply of packing materials where e-commerce operator charging commission from supplier of good?
They want to know the place of supply of e-commerce services or the movement or the good packaging the product.
Yeah,
goods is will be Delhi only.
Okay. So I don't see more questions. Shivam sir, Rajiv sir.
There's a question. What is the implication under GST when same product is being sold offline in market with higher MRP and online sale with lower MRP? Goods are same in all the respects. I think no GST implication on that. I think whatever prices it is being sold, GST will be applicable on that.
What I think you're go ahead. Please go ahead.
So I was saying, yes, it's a valuation question, and this is a practice which is known everywhere, known right. Around. So, yeah, so it's an independent price which was given. It was offered higher or lower. As far as long as it's the independent price offered, it'll be acceptable.
Right. Only thing is, though it's not a G, he's only asking from GST perspective. Online sales with lower MRP. Question will be whether he can have two MRP on the same product under the legal metrology law. Kindly get that thing checked. Because that's another disputable area. Legal metrology can question if you have two MRP on the same product, then there can be a problem. So though he has not asked that.
MRP I think would be the same, but they are giving discounts when we buy online, isn't it?
So it's because this question saying online sale with a lower MRP. So same product, one package, two MRP, legal metrology challenge can be there. GST, right. Like Pratibha and you are correctly saying, no problem. Also, If somebody from the anti-profiteering authority is looking at and you are saying that I am lowering the price to pass on, etc., and you already have profited in the past, this
right
has to be seen from that angle also. Though otherwise valuation.
Yeah. Can we take up some more questions?
So I think so. There's a problem in connections. So I'll maybe take up the questions.
Both the speakers are not there.
Seems so. I think we can end the session, sir.
Okay. So I think most of the queries have been answered, and it was wonderful having all of you here and listening to so attentively to the webinar. And we'll continue the series. And tomorrow, as you are aware, that the third day we'll be having Rohini Agarwalji for the session on RCM. So we request you all to join and share all this link with others also, so everybody can be benefit. Thank you so much for joining. And we also thank the learned speakers for the deliberations and the wonderful explanation of the various points that they raised, and also the answering the various questions. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you all the participants as well for attending the event. As sir already mentioned, we're having the third day of this series, which is tomorrow. So I hope everyone will join and share this link as well. Thank you so much.